96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
I'm not afraid to take a stand.
Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by Burger King, Royal Fidelity Bank and Trust, Royal Star Assurance, and the Water and Sewage Department.
If you feel like you make it down the same road,
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio. 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. I'm so glad that you could join us today. Our numbers, usual as they are today, if you want to give us a call, are 323-6232. 323-6232 or 325-4316. 325-4316 or 325-4259. That's 325-4259. You can also text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. And you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. A couple of things I want to discuss today. Both have to do with comments made by cabinet ministers in the minister administration. And both, I think, are worthy of discussion. You'll recall that in speaking about Lanisha Rowe's comments the other day, I said, you know, colleagues have to have a certain degree of regard for each other and to be able to treat each other with dignity in such a way that even if they have to part company, that it is done in a way that's not injurious, doesn't injure, doesn't harm the dignity of the colleague or doesn't harm the organization, which can only benefit from unity and addition and multiplication as opposed to subtraction and division. And I indicated that one of the great concerns I had with the way Lanisha Rowe and then Mark Humes felt they had been handled was that it ran the risk of having this kind of negativity occur. Well, as it turns out, the Minister of Agriculture and Marine Resources, Mr. Michael Pintard, in making his budget contribution alluded to this. Now, let me say that he too lived up to his own billing of someone who makes substantive contributions. He was, you know, I would have to say that he was fulsome in his reporting on the work of his ministry. Michael Pintard, I believe that there have been other serious ministers of agriculture in the history of our country, meaning that in particular, they took a keen interest in advancing, pushing for the Bahamian farmer, Fisher, to get opportunities in the Bahamas. I believe that is true. I could name some, but I don't want to get caught up in that right now. But I do not believe that I have seen a minister, and if you were a minister of agriculture and feel like this is, I'm being perhaps unfair to you, please forgive me. Maybe I wasn't paying as much attention, but I don't know that there has been a minister of agriculture that has taken a more studied scientific approach to the issue of agriculture and marine resources as is Michael Pintard. And I you can tell in his reporting the degree of consultation, the degree of studying, the degree of attempts to objectify or make objective considerations of agriculture, and to put yourself in a position where your policy choices and considerations are being fueled by information. And so he gave a very substantive contribution in the House of Assembly yesterday. But he was moved sufficiently to speak about his view that both political parties tend to handle some of their folk with insensitivity. He made, he didn't call any particular member's name on his side, but he alluded to the fact that both sides do it, and he did call Paisville Forbes' name in the example of the Progressive Liberal Party. I don't think it was hard to tell that he could have been alluding to either Lanisha Rose's circumstances or Mark Hume's circumstances, because he mentioned, listening to one of the members, he said he was hurt and brought to tears because of what he understood to have been, have transpired, you know? And the reason I point this out is because it makes the point that so many of you responded to when I made it the first time. The point being that very often men and women are bound together not so much by principle as much as they are bound together by interest. And so it, as it turns out, you know, when your interest and somebody else's interest part company, for example, we no longer see you as a viable candidate to help us win the next election. We no longer think that you can contribute to the cause, your treatment turns out to be one that can be quite callous versus you're a valuable person perceived as someone capable of helping us win, or at the very least helping us lose if we part company. And so you get treated a certain kind of way when that happens. And that's why it is important for candidates. You know, you got a lot of young candidates, new candidates going to run in this upcoming election. take on the romance if you want. Believe that you are, in fact, the comrades that they say you are. That may be true. It may be true. Or it may not be true. And there's nothing wrong with being clear-eyed about, you know what? They think I could help them. I think they could help me. Because you many, many times, you get into these parties because you think they can help you advance your ambition to be on the national scene to make a political contribution. Whether that is selfish or principled, I don't know. Nobody can tell. Nobody has the right to, nobody can fairly and accurately judge your motivations outside of what you say. So nobody knows what's in your heart. You know, maybe there may be some of you who from day one you became an enlightened adult. You felt like I wanted to make a contribution to the Bahamas, and politics is the way I think I can do it. Maybe you or somebody who thought, listen, I just like that lifestyle the politicians seem to have, and that glory and that glitz and that glamour, and I want that. Maybe you don't have a clue. Maybe you, somebody just came and approached you and you decided this is what I want to do because it seemed nice. I don't know. But at least be clear-eyed about this reality, my friend. And this reality isn't always This is sometimes more true for some people than it is for others. Very often, you are simply a piece of a puzzle to win an election. That's all. And in the day your piece don't fit, you will be discarded like it was never a big deal. And as long as you are clear-eyed about that, you won't be crushed. You won't be crushed by the reality that, you know what? Let me not wait for them to judge my value. Let me judge it myself. You know what? I think that my stock ain't as high as it used to be or may not be high at all. And I think I better prepare to be dismissed. Because the reality is, in the world of politics, the players aren't some spiritual, religious clan bound to brotherly love and sisterly love that means that they are going to lay their life down for you. Let me tell you something. In the politics that I have participated in and observed, it is seldom that anyone would lay down their life for you. And let me tell you something. The Bible said, Jesus said, listen, greater love of no man than this, than that a man lay down his life for a friend. Now, you got to ask yourself, is these people really my friends or are they just my associates? Because if the situation calls for you or them going, what do you think is going to happen 99% of the time? It's going to be them. And there are some personalities in politics and in life who are so self-centered, so focused on their own thing that you are a liability if you threaten that, and you are only valuable if you enhance that. And what I'm saying to you is just be clear-eyed, grow up, wake up, and understand in the community of human beings, men are bound together very often by interest and not principle. See, a principle says, this is the rule between us, whether we are in Germany or China or Africa or South America or North America or the Bahamas. Whether we are in 1984 or we are in 2054, this is the rule between us. A principle says that whether you are black or white, rich or poor, young or old, this is the rule between us. That is what makes people lay their life down for you, not interest. You are only as good to some people as you are capable of serving their interest. And so I understand, you know, Michael Pintad, I've known him a very long time. I've always told him he has a huge heart. It's a reality. I've known him a long time. Huge heart for people. And I've said to him on occasions, I said, yours is bigger than mine. I have to tell you, you know. But the reality is you have to be clear-eyed about the nature of politics. And unfortunately, politics is not the only place that does this. There are other professions that does this. But politics is one of those places where egos become raw and naked. And self-interest can become pronounced. And where camaraderie can be fiend with exceptional acting ability. Okay, let me tell you, plenty of politicians could get Grammy awards. I mean, Oscars, you just get Grammy for singing. Get Oscars for the job done to fiend sincerity and sincere love and appreciation. There are some who haven't, mind you. I've seen it. But boy, don't fool yourself, is all I'm saying. Some of you young men and women, don't fool yourself, yeah? Don't fool yourself. I know what's going to happen. I've been in these campaigns. Oh, these people are going to, your comrades, they love you. And we're all one and we're together and so forth and so forth and so forth. And you go through the campaign because you know you can't be talking about each other and then trying to win. So you can get that kind of camaraderie and you're all going to go and shake up your pom-poms and go on them stage and all that music and give those wonderful speeches and get all that rah-rah and tell you win or you lose. Tell you win or you lose. See what happens after that. Because when you win, and if you win big, now the man start dealing up the positions. And you ain't get the one you wanted. Now you're going to find out, or you get one somebody else wanted. Now you're going to find out, were we really comrades? Were we really bound together by principle? Is they really celebrating with me that I have been given this responsibility? Or is they now cutting me down to say, how in the world did he get that? Did she get that? Uh-oh. When you lose, bro, how you doing? Man, everything cool, but I got to go. But me and you just used to talk. Man, things different now. And all I'm saying is wake up, grow up, and understand the business you are in. Sometimes for genuine and legitimate reasons, somebody might come to you and say, no, you know, I know you might have been expecting X, Y, and Z, but it's not going to happen. For legitimate reasons. Don't get hurt. Don't get hurt. Yeah, they were cool with you, but it ain't that kind of party. Oh, boy. What I'm saying is, wake up, grow up, and understand the nature of the business you have entered. You know, some members of the band in public have the same problem. You know, they get shocked, too, when... In quote, they get treated a certain kind of way before election, then after election, and so forth and so forth. Well, guess what? Politicians, by some of you, get treated one way before election and after election. When you thought he was going to win, when you thought she was going to win, you was all in. Then they lose, and now you treat them as cold and callous as it comes. Let me tell you something. There was a person in one of the constituencies that I ran in. I mean, I thought, this was my thought, my own foolishly. I thought we had a good relationship. I did some things that I thought was advancing and helping that person's cause and so forth and so forth. On election day, person showed up to the polls, adorned with my opponent's clothing, worked in the background for my opponent, and said this to me, I shall never forget it. You know, and said it in a way where, honestly, I had to just wake the hell up and say, okay. Said to me, next time, you will not be so naive. Listen to me, man. All I'm telling you is, put your big man and woman stuff on and understand what you are entering. The vast majority of relationships you have in politics are not about any principled, authentic love and appreciation of you. They are transactional. The hope and expectation is you do something for me, I can do something for you. And when that ends, you and I are simply people who knew each other or know each other casually. It's reality. I ain't inviting you to my house so we can have dinner, go to lunch, and me and you can hang out. That's not gonna happen. While we are colleagues, we might do it because that's just a way we could, you know, hang out. But after that, I don't want you to think it's more than that. I'm being as straight-eyed with you about it and straightforward with you about it because I am trying to warn you. Don't get caught up. Don't get mixed up. It ain't that kind of party. Know what you're in. If your heart is earnest and you are sincere about what you do the very best you can, do not be fooled into thinking that anyone simply is trying to ensure that every single good in the world comes to you. But you are as valuable as you are valuable. And let me tell you something. I'm going to tell you all a secret who's going into politics. Y'all think I should tell you? I'm going to tell you how to have the most value and the most power in politics. Most value, the most power. But I'm going to read some of these. I'm going to read sex phrase. If you are interested in politics, if you are going in politics, if you are running now, I'm going to tell you how to be the most valuable and resilient and resistant to bad treatment in politics. Right after I read some of these texts. Says, good afternoon, sir. Do you think Mr. Pindad should resign for the comments made? No, he shouldn't resign for the comments made. Why should he resign? Because he expressed his view about treatment. Now, let me explain something to you. If you say something that you do not believe has been unethical or dishonest or has harmed your party in any way, when in point of fact, in any significant way, when in point of fact, you speak of a principle and the truth that you believe applies to both sides, why should you resign now? If the prime minister don't like it, if he don't like it, even if you don't think you did anything wrong, he has a right to do something about it. But why should he resign? If he needed to resign because what he thought before he said it was so egregious, he should have resigned before that. So why resign because you said it? You said it, you must have thought it was important to say. Now, I don't believe he should resign, but the prime minister certainly reserves the right to decide whether he thinks he should resign. That's a different story. I keep telling y'all before, a prime minister could wake up in the morning, decide he didn't like the necktie you wore, and tell you, listen, please tender your resignation, and he don't need to give you no explanation. That's the way it is. This text says, good afternoon, sir. Do you think, Mr. Pindad? Oh, sorry, I read the same thing, sorry. Says, now, I love you, but you know the treatment is not automatically binary. There are degrees of treatments on the decency scale, as you well know. The tragedy is, I think, that there was no man big enough and or the competent authority is not generally open to such respectful treatment unless it benefits him directly and politically. But I don't know, treatment, there can be treatment in degrees, maybe, yeah, but I mean, collegiality. there is the, take for instance, a cabinet. It is as unique a club as you are going to get in. Then take the parliament. It is as unique a club as you're going to get in, right? Collegiality is collegiality. And yes, if you disrespect somebody, maybe you can expect disrespect, but ordinarily the mature don't operate like that. Not the mature, all right? I know of circumstances in which others may have felt a certain kind of way with me, and I don't think to this day they are even would have been aware of what I knew and understood about how they felt about me. What does that make to me? My responsibility is to treat others with collegiality. That's my responsibility, right? So binary for me is not the domain of the mature. We are not told do unto others what you don't want them to do to you. We're told do unto others what you want them to do to you. That's what we're told. We want to do unto others what they do to you. So, it may you what how somebody treats you may invoke a reaction, but it doesn't have to. This text says, Mr. Lang, I thought the party was supposed to look out for all members. Based on your comments, it doesn't seem so. Seriously? My comments suggest to you that the party shouldn't look out for our members? Wow, I must have been really unpleasant. You say, if that is the case, your comments yesterday about thinking about the collective instead of the individual only applies to public health. If so, why should we care about the collective when we have leaders that care about self-interest? I have to tell you, I don't know what you are listening to. Honestly, I do not know. And I must have been really unclear. But my point is, for if you are a member, you know, when you interact with people, right, because they're friendly with you, doesn't mean they love you. Doesn't mean they lay their life down for you. That's the point I made. It's not a statement of what ought to be the case. It's a statement of what in reality is often the case. So a party should look out for all members. It should. And all members should look out for the party. And all members should look out for each other. But it is foolish to live in a world of them when in reality the world is showing you it ain't oughtn't like that. Right? That's foolish. That's stupid. It's stupid to say, you know, every time I touch this particular water in the kettle, it been cool. But now somebody just heated up the water and it hot. It would be foolish of you to say, but I can't accept that. The water should be cool. What do you mean the water should be cool? It hot now. And then the same thing in life. Expectations are just that, expectations. But reality is reality. And anyone who has participated in politics knows that you can very often be in a situation where you are only as valuable to people as you are able to serve their interest. Right? Now, my own experience was that we had quite a collegial arrangement between us, but I was under no delusions about the extent of that collegiality. No delusions. Okay? I thought we had a level of maturity, though, to be able to bypass our personal feelings toward each other and get the work done. We were able to do that. And so I didn't see, I didn't say it ain't happened, but I didn't see too many examples of sucker punching each other going on. I saw some examples of it though. And if I gave you some examples of it, it'll shock the living daylights out of you. Say, well, then we shouldn't look out for others in public space. Well, stop talking nonsense. Stop trying to justify your nonsense. Stop it. Absolute nonsense. Because all the world decides to go to hell, you shouldn't try to go to heaven. Because all the world decides to hate, you shouldn't love. I'm talking nonsense. It's a difference between being aware of the circumstances you are in and conforming to the circumstances. Stop talking nonsense. We can take a break. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this. Break. Afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Work hard. Shouldn't your money be working hard too? RF Mutual Funds are designed to put your money to work with some of the best performing investment funds in the market and a range of funds to suit your unique needs. So when you're hard at work, you can be confident your money is too. Put your money to work with RF Mutual Funds. Call us at 603-6000 or visit rfgroup.com to learn more. RF, money at work.
You asked for it, and now it's here. Introducing the all-new plant-based Rebel Whopper only at Burger King NASA. The new Rebel Whopper is everything you expect in a Whopper with a meatless plant-based patty that is flame-grilled to perfection with all the fixins you love on that famous sesame seed bun. Come try out the new Rebel Whopper with fries and a Pepsi and see if you can tell the difference. The Rebel Whopper is 100% Whopper, 0% beef, and only at Burger King NASA, where taste is king.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Mo's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance, I pulled my phone out, pulled up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep. Sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, got that kind of...
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Meet Jackie. Jackie's a hard worker with a steady income, but she has a personal loan and multiple credit cards to pay off. To keep her account current, Jackie opted for a loan from Fidelity Bank to consolidate her debt into one monthly payment and earn interest on a built-in savings account. Be like Jackie. Call 356-7764 to book a complimentary financial coaching session. Fidelity also offers virtual assistance. Fidelity, we're good for you.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather, cold or warm. Let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down the same road.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp us on 439-3043. You know, for people who believe the Bible to be true and an accurate accounting of things, Jesus said, listen, many will come to you like wolves in sheep clothing. I wonder why would Jesus tell people that? Why would he say that? Not all who say, Lord, Lord, will enter. Depart from me, ye worker of iniquity, I knew you not. Why would he say that? Let the wheat and the tare grow together. Why would he say that? Because he wanted people to know the reality of the world in which they live. and if you have in the context of the religious, people who can act contrary to the principles that they espouse, and as we do, what do you think is going to happen in environments where people aren't even pretending that that is the focal point of their existence? What do you expect? So just be bright-eyed about it, young man, young woman. Be earnest when you talk to people in trying to share to them what you can do. Try to find that earnestness and sincerity in yourself first. It may not have been the reason you started out, but at least you can adjust your thinking and your mindset so that you can take on that sincerity. Recognize that these folk that you're going to campaign to are looking for you to better their lives. And not necessarily looking for you to better the community's life. They're looking for you to better their life. They need a job. They need a government house. They need a government job. They want their situation better off individually to have with anybody else. Recognize that that is so. And don't be deluded into thinking that every single person you meet and campaign with is interested in the collective well-being of the Bahamas. That's not true. And that recognition will just help you to understand when you hear things that causes you to think, wow, God, I didn't realize it was like this. So you didn't realize it was like this because you never thought through it. I had a fella ask me for $30 when I was campaigning. I tell him, no, I'm not going to give you $30. Fellow tell him, so you ain't get my vote. I said, well, okay. Because if that's the kind of member of parliament you need, I am not it. Right? And that could happen. We had a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Go ahead, caller. Hello? Okay. We apparently don't have a caller on the line. I am simply trying to be helpful to those who would put themselves in the way, in indicating that you have to grow up. Some people may be older, like you could be in your 50s and 60s and campaigning and going into campaign and still deluded about what the realities of things are. And if you're not careful, if you keep doing that, you'll hurt yourself or you will be hurt. Right? It isn't often hard to discern where people, what people motives are in doing what they do to you or around you. You know, it's not always that difficult. Let me tell you why. I got this from a psychiatrist, actually. And the psychiatrist said that if you want to discern somebody's motive, more often than not, just ask yourself this question. What is the end result of the thing that they or things they are doing? Let me say it again. He said, if you want to figure out what a person's motive is, just ask yourself, what comes about from what they are doing or saying or not doing or not saying? In other words, if, for instance, there is a consistency of behavior between you and somebody that makes you feel bad, then it is reasonable to assume that their motive is to make you feel bad. If somebody's actions consistently undermine your authority, make you look weak and awful and incompetent in the front of people with whom you work, then it is reasonable to assume that they are trying to make you look weak and incompetent around the people with whom you work. That makes sense. Because generally speaking, we act to produce a result. And if the result that somebody is producing on you is consistently negative, bad, etc., chances are that's what their motive is, to produce a bad result for you. If they keep producing a good result for you, chances are it's to produce a good result for you. So let me give you a hint, right? If every time you go to a person, you go to a house, they hang you up for a long time, but never ever commit to supporting you and so forth and so forth, chances are their motive is to hold you up from being able to get the other people to cap in. If they wanted to be helpful to you, then the things they do would be helpful to you. So observe people, observe their behavior, observe their conduct, and pay attention to the result that it gets. What did Jesus say? By their fruit, ye shall know them. By the results of their actions, behavior, you shall know them. Now, fruit is something that develops. So it isn't always instant that you will get to see the fruit. You have to observe over time. Because let me tell you something. There are pretenders who can pretend for a long time, but they are a special case of pretenders. They're really wicked, evil people. Amateur fakers can't do that for a long time. They can't fight, they can't fake like you knew for a long time. I even tell people this, listen, man, telling me you love me don't mean much because Jesus told us to love our enemies. Is you like me? I heard a comedian say the other day, say, you know, I've seen people murder their loved ones, but I ain't never heard about somebody murdering someone they like. And I thought to myself, that's interesting. That's really interesting. Right? So you got to have your eyes wide open, behavior and examining the results of behavior. So let me give you an example as a collective, right? The government of the Bahamas, administrations of the Bahamas are acting. And if you can objectively examine the results, and I say objectively because some of us, we ain't right in our head sometimes in the way we deal with life, right? Because we can't be objective to save our own life. We cannot. I'm talking about the community of the reason. If you can objectively ask yourself, what has been the result of their actions? Not what has been the result of the global pandemic, mind you, because that has acted upon everybody. But in terms of government action, what has been the result? And that result may point to you in terms of two things. Either what has the government been attempting to do, or it might say, how capably has the government what it intended to do? So question, does the character and the values of a prime minister set the tone and influence in a cabinet, or does the cabinet ministers plural set the tone and culture by their expressed values in the cabinet meetings? I can't speak for every cabinet, but I can, deducing what I have seen, say that the prime minister's character and values matters a hell of a lot. It matters a hell of a lot. And I would say that it is more often the case that the prime minister's stance, character, values sets the tone for his cabinet than the other way around. I would say that for the most part. Oh, so I didn't tell you all what the secret is to being making sure that you don't get treated the same way in politics. I didn't tell you all. I'm giving this secret to the young campaigners, candidates, etc. Let me tell you what the secret is. You see what I'm saying, people? Y'all campaign too? See those same people that you went and made promises to? If you keep them close and they truly, truly respect, love, and regard you, you are near untouchable in politics. Near untouchable. And that's the hard part of it. They may vote for the party when they first voted for you. But if you can serve them in a way that the majority of them love, value, and appreciate you, who work with and leave it, they will have to be careful how they treat you. Mr. Ingram used to say a lot of times, he said, you know, if you don't like this, what I'm doing, Caesar could always appeal to the people. In other words, he understood, at least at certain points, that the people regarded him in a certain way. And that was his power. In politics, the popularity you have with people is the power you have with your colleagues. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Chicago Live, your host. Ponder that. We'll be back after the news break.
Take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand.
Shouldn't your money be working hard too? RF Mutual Funds are designed to put your money to work with some of the best performing investment funds in the market and a range of funds to suit your unique needs and risk tolerance. So when you're hard at work, you can be confident your money is too. Put your money to work with RF Mutual Funds. Call us at 603-6000 or visit rfgroup.com to learn more. RF, money at work.
The Water and Sewage Corporation advises residents of Tropical Gardens and Alexandria Boulevard East, Nassau Village, who may be planning new construction or have commenced new construction and have not yet done and are planning to do so, to urgently apply for city supply due to upcoming road paving works. The corporation will not be able to accept any new applications due to the roads having already been paved. For further information, please call 302-5599.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon, where we began our show to comments about the need for political parties to be more sensitive to their members, particularly when they are considering dropping them. I have a text here that says, good afternoon. It sounds like you are contradicting everything you said yesterday about the idea of a community and a nation. I'm honestly confused. You sound like a different host from yesterday. I'm sure you are confused. Very confused. Because if you can't tell the difference between understanding the reality of individual interest in a collective business like politics, and understanding that so that you are not shocked when you get certain treatments, and the difference between that and encouraging a community to understand how public health works in a communal context, I just can't speak the English you need. I'm sorry. Because lots of other people seem to get the point, but I can't. I'm sorry, I can't help you beyond that. Maybe you should be listen to the show. Maybe you'll get it later. A little better. All right. So I think we have some other text here. Let me read those before I move on. This text says I'm going to read. This text says, hey Zhivargo, my boy, Shay Sang PLP is the only thing we won in 2012. That's how I vote PLP. Then he switch and sing the Rita Mali version of One Draw and say, tell PLP bye. That was powerful. Now I wonder what and who he will sing for this cycle. I just enjoy his performances. He is very creative. Okay. His text is, remember, sir, Mr. Pinta, notably in one of the most, is one of the most effective and efficient MPs and ministers. And he has among the last of the, he's the last, one among the last of the ministers, MPs to be ratified. The last of the ministers, MPs to be ratified. He knows how it feels. Paiswell, Anisha, Chanel, and Mark were in the hot box. Okay. His text says, you was Mr. Ingram's blue-eyed boy. Okay, if you think so. His text says, Mr. Laing, your comments are the hard, real statements that many need to hear. The same applies to these jobs that some of our people are so dedicated to. Keep being real. I don't know no other way. Thank you. Says, I wonder if we contributed to the thinking of the electorate by making promises we did as politicians that contributed to the thinking of self-upliftment and selfishness rather than thinking more nationalistic or what's in the best interest of the Haymans or the Bahamas, no matter the party. I don't think that had I don't think that the promises had anything to do with it, because if you read the manifesto of the Free National Movement and what it promised, in the manifesto, it doesn't say, I'm going to get you a personal job, I'm going to get you a government job. It doesn't. Kinds of things that are promised are quite national, right? Let me give you an example. Enforce a zero tolerance for crime, inclusive of minor infractions of the law. Is that in the best interest of the Bahamas or not? That promise. Develop a modern, efficient crime-fighting machine, properly manned, trained, educated, and equipped to prevent crime where possible, detect crime when it occurs, and bring those responsible to account before the courts. Is that in the best interest of the country? Establish, build, and equip an independent forensic lab. And I could go on and on and on and on, and who would say that's not in the best interest? The Progressive Liberal Party has a economic plan. And in their plan, they say they want to provide immediate relief in COVID. They want to stabilize the government's finances. They want to kickstart the economy and job creation. Are those not in the best interest of the country? No, I don't think so. Even if you look at the individual candidates' platforms, brochures, they're saying things like build a community center, build a parks, et cetera. They're not promising people to give hands and so forth and so forth. Now, so it's not the promises that's the problem. It's sometimes how we act in response to the individual pleadings of voters that might encourage them to think selfishly. Because when you react to some selfish request to fix my things and my people or my children in order to get a vote, yes, you may get that reaction. You may get that conditioning by some people. As Texas, Mr. Laing, it is my belief that the action or the reason which led the response of Mr. Pintard is very reason why many qualified, progressive, and potentially hardworking Bahamians shy away from frontline politics, all because of the weak leaders and jokey councils. I believe you. I can tell you that that is probably true for some professionals for sure. So can't deny that. Okay, let's move on. Mr. Ellsworth, the Honorable Ellsworth Johnson. I have a call on the line. Let me take the call. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hi, Mr. Mike. How are you?
Hey, I'm doing okay. And yourself?
I'm good. Thank you. Thank God for life.
Very good.
You know, something you said earlier when you were giving advice to campaign workers. As in reference to the residents hanging, have them hanging up.
Yes.
Like,
you know how that works, right?
No, but I don't necessarily agree with you, you know, because sometimes,
oh, really?
Because constituents generally have, especially when the candidate is there, they really genuinely have concerns.
I remember, in my experience,
I'm the late Mr. Wells, Tennyson Wells,
right,
campaigned by my home, right?
Right.
And I really wanted to speak with him.
Right.
And, you know, he came and he shook my hand and, you know, he said he was really appreciate our, you know, my support, right?
Right, right.
I said, but sir, I said, he, you know, he said, thank you. And he turned, started to walk away. So I called him back. I said, please give me a minute. You know, I invited him inside. He sat down.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and I was really, really concerned about the young people because I have a son and a daughter who were teenagers, you know, at the time.
Right.
And I was really concerned about the youth. And
okay.
I asked him, you know, and he came, mind you, he came in, he sat down, and
mm-hmm.
he gave me, you know, he couldn't go into details, right?
Right.
But he took the time out, and he really, really explained and you know, what his plans were and everything else, and I appreciated that.
Yeah,
so,
but
I didn't go on and say, okay, now you finished with that. Let me see what your idea on this or what I need or whatever like that. It wasn't asking for anyone, looking for him to give me anything like, you know, monetarily. But these are, you know, sometimes you have constituents who really have concerns in reference to that, especially when, you have to be able, you have to have your campaign workers. They have to have training as well.
But listen. I'm 100% in agreement with you about what you said about the anecdotal situation you mentioned. But now,
right,
you have to have heard all that I said, though. I said, if somebody is continuously keeping, holding you up, so forth. Yeah, you see, because let me tell you something. This is what I was talking about ain't theoretical. I've been through this. So here's what happens, right? Mm-hmm. Especially when you're a young candidate. You keep going around a particular place and you find that, boy, every time you get there, they're hanging you up with almost accusative questioning, right? And so forth. And then you find out, you know, your folks say, but Mr. Lai, I'm sorry, but, you know, they are avid opposite to you. They know what they're doing. They are trying to hold you up. And they smile and laugh at you when your workers tell you,
yeah, that's a whole different scenario with that. Now,
and,
you know,
and
you,
that's what I was.
And you trapped, that's why you have that, those papers or those things which you travel,
right.
You campaign with. So
that's
you can tick these things off and whatever. And one more thing before I go, mm-hmm. I just want to give my sympathy to the family of Mrs. Fernanda, who passed.
Yes.
She made a huge contribution to early childhood education in this country. For many years, she and Mrs. Helen Rose.
Right.
And I count her energy, her enthusiasm, her support with persons who wanted to open up preschools and, you know, daycare centers all over this country. And
right.
She put in the work in reference to curriculum and all of that good stuff. So I would not allow this day to pass without I pay a tribute to her. On behalf of her family, and I would hope that going forward, that she would be recognized for the contribution, because for far too long we just forget our people. Sometimes persons who have, you know, you don't hear too much about them. They do what they have to do. They go and sit down quietly. But you know her, she can never get enough roses or whatever. You know, but you know, with her passing, she has to be memorialized. For her contribution to education with our babies and our children, because you see what's going on there with early childhood. She did that. She was a part of that, not just what we see here today. She was a part of that, the whole beginning of this great thing. So I want her to be recognized, Mrs. Fernando. Thank you so much for listening.
I thank you very much. I have words to say about her, but I didn't want to and don't want to still. Because I like to confirm things before too much, because I have seen us prematurely announce and mention things, and I don't want to do it. So, but I agree with you and lots of things you said about Ms. Fernanda, but I want to reserve my time to deal with that. Thank you very much for calling. Yeah. I people know, we know the games that get played. I campaigned in four different campaigns over a 20-year non-consecutive period. So I know the games that people play. And so I was talking about some of the games that people play. You can have very genuine, earnest voters who want to know and will try to get as much information out of you. But I found the ones who are most respectful of all that you are seeking to do, as earnest as they want, understand that they cannot command your time for 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours with regularity every time you come to visit, and do it in a manner that says, you know what, hey, you're trying to stall me. So but I appreciate that there are people who can want to take time to do so. Says you missed it. I'm not talking about the written manifesto. I'm talking about the off the book, behind the scenes promises. But I acknowledge that. Did you not hear me say that now you could be right when it comes to how people respond to the demands made on them? So no, I didn't miss anything you said. I appreciate it though. Appreciate you. So the Honorable Ellsworth Johnson, the Minister of Financial Services and Immigration, announced recently in his budget contribution that the government is eyeing a $1 million minimum for investors to qualify for economic permanent residencies by making non-real estate investments in the Bahamas. a cabinet minister revealed. This is from the newspaper article attributing to him. So in other words, we are looking, this is in quote, a quote attributed to the minister, says we are looking at least $1 million investments by such persons to be able to qualify for permanent residency, economic permanent residency. He says eligibility can also be based on a combination of the purchase of a home, other investments. We are essentially introducing a broader, more flexible approach to economic permanent residence than that takes into account the kinds of investments, not simply limiting it to the purchase of a residence. So when we did a comparative analysis, this is Mr. Johnson, of other jurisdictions and wanting to be competitive and improve our competitive edge, we saw there are a number of other jurisdictions that have an investment component. Now, I like the direction that this thought is going. It is not inconsistent with a set of principles that I was trying to lay down in the last Ingram administration around this issue of permanent residency and investments. And my hope is that the government will take its time, not too much time, but take some time and think this through thoroughly. Think it through thoroughly. First of all, we have had in the investment policy of the Bahamas for decades now, at least since 1993, that if you make an investment of a certain amount, and it has changed over time, when it was initially introduced, it was $500,000. Then I think it went to $750,000 and so forth and so forth. Where it stands now, I'm not entirely sure. But we've had in that investment policy, our published national investment policy, that if you make such an investment or buy a home, or construct a home of that order, you can be given accelerated consideration for permanent residency. It has also been the policy of the government of the Bahamas that if you have made a substantial enough investment in the country, that a consideration of your application for permanent residency would also be accelerated. That's been a standing policy for the most part, right? We have limited consideration of permanent residency largely in terms of investing to building a home and maybe making some substantial investment in a business, a company. But why I say I hope the government gives this really good consideration is because I think that the approach we are taking to permanent residency is depriving us of some opportunity. Let me say what I mean. Okay. First of all, let's be clear. When the minister is here talking about permanent residence, he's talking mostly about high net worth individuals now. He's not talking, to be able to buy or construct a home for $1 million, you got to be somebody with disposable income, substantial disposable income, what we call a high net worth individual. If you can invest in a home with cash and that don't affect the rest of your financial circumstances, you are what we call a high net worth individual. And so we're not talking about just anybody. Now, I want you to think about a high net worth individual. Let's think about somebody with the ability to spend $1 million and don't feel it. Cash and no feeling. That's not their substantial home, right? Because when you have definitions of high net worth individuals, generally speaking, if you're talking about them having disposable income of say $1 million or more, that a lot of some definitions have that that is separate and apart from their substantive whom. Okay, if you're talking about such a person, you're talking about somebody with a great deal of disposable income. Ladies and gentlemen, let me ask you a question. What would happen in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas if, forget the foreigner now, forget the foreigner, if 1,000 Bahamians came into the ability to spend $1 million and it didn't hurt them? 1,000 Bahamians, that's $1 billion to be spent. What would happen? Your economy would grow by $1 billion in the first instance and by multiplier by two and a half times that much. Think about that for a moment. You came into the ability to spend $1 million and it don't impact your financial circumstances in any way because you could afford it. You spending that throughout the Bahamas. The impact of that on your economic circumstances would be significant, right? Okay. Well, Bahamians aren't going to come into that kind of reality instantaneously. It's not that they can't. We could do it over time. We could have 1,000 Bahamians come into that status over time. But we're not going to be able to do that over the next year, 2 years, 3 years. But there are people in the world with that ability. And they then decide, I would like to live in the Bahamas, you know, but not only live in the Bahamas, I'd like to be a permanent documentation that establishes my residency here and allows me to move in and out of the country as freely as possible. I can't vote. I didn't want to vote. I just want to be a permanent resident. And they have millions of dollars at their disposal. Okay, millions of dollars. Now, I ask you a question. If such a person wanted to come and live in the Bahamas, what might they do to come and live here? Might they not build a home? Well, more than likely they would. Might they not lease a property that they tie in for a substantial period of time? They might well do so. They might purchase a condominium. They might decide, I'm gonna just stay in a timeshare for 6 months of the year. I can afford it. And when they come bringing not their money, but their ability to spend because their money exists in the world. And might they then not require all manner of things in their living here for a period of time or however long they decide in the course of a year to live? What I find we do is we are just like, in some instances, these people who are investors and not developers. Let me tell you what, investors want their money on the front end. That's why you see them trade. Some investors, you have some investors who trade for the long haul, but that ain't a lot. These people who play the market, man, they try to get in, get out. Developers understand, in many instances, I get my money on the back end. And so if we only think about getting the hit of $1 million through the construction of a home, and not think about the long haul from having somebody reside in the country meaningfully, we may miss the boat. And so we have to think through our permanent residency ties to economic gains more meaningfully, is what I'm saying. And not think about it so short-termism, not think about it as a get a hit from them and move on. Because you have some of these people, they can build a house here and spend 2 weeks, 2 months here, and they don't mean nothing. But you have others who, under the right set of circumstances, would truly spend time here, making their permanent residence really meaningful. And with that, you get the benefit of all their spending in your economy. Because at the end of the day, really, that's the transaction between you and them. They get to live here. and you get to benefit from their economic transactions here. And we can get that meaningful hit. And we can get this perhaps injection and sustained benefit relatively quickly if we can note what the real hindrance is to permanent residency in the country. Listen, I think about this now. What are you giving up to a high net worth individual? You're not giving up anything. You are giving them the privilege of dwelling in your country for a time without the right to vote. Largely living in spaces and places where they can afford to do so, where many cannot afford and do so. So I think there's opportunities here. But I think we have to think through those opportunities carefully and not think about this so much in terms of, oh, if you invest this amount, and all of those could be qualifiers. But there are other ways. Let me give you an example, right? You have retired professionals like engineers and educators and professors with fairly handsome nest eggs. They have saved up $2-4 million to live in retirement. They're in retirement now. They don't work no more. They don't work for 30-40 years. They decide, I'd like to retire in the Bahamas, maybe even live here in part-time or fully. Why such a person would not take their nest egg and build a $1 million home? But who cares if they don't build a $1 million home? If they come here and want to rent something of $1,000-$2,000 with that nest egg contributing to your economy, how does that hurt you? Doesn't. So we have to think about it more broadly. We have to think about the fact that what we want are people with economic disposable income to be here to enhance and augment our population. I can see the arguments where we talk about having to bring in or having individuals who come in whose means are meager or non-existent. I can understand the challenge there. But a retired professional with a handsome nest egg, a 401k plan that they're now liquidated, somebody with a high net worth, what's the struggle to have them come here? And you know what the big challenge with us is? It isn't whether it's $1 million or $750,000 or $500,000. Let's be real. If you are a high net worth individual, what a $150,000, $250,000 difference make to you? Come on, man, that's what me and you think like, because that's where our money is. We think that's a big difference, right? These folk, man, come on, that's play money for some of these folk. They're spending that in Monaco and in the south of France and so forth and so forth. This is the Bahamas. So I don't think the impediment is the $1 million or the $750,000 or what? The impediment in the Bahamas is slowness of our process. You put in an application to a law firm, an accounting firm, to somebody, and too many of them, first of all, it takes them forever to get the application in. And then on top of that, it takes the process a long time to get the application to the national, to the immigration board for consideration. And then when it gets to the immigration board with all the other piles of things at the immigration board, it takes them too long and months to get an answer. Listen, if you are a high net worth individual, could live almost anywhere in the world you want, why would you hang up yourself reading the F in the Bahamas? And why would the Bahamas not seek to say, you know what, let's process these things, mind you? I will tell you, I can only tell you by my own experience, Mr. Ingram didn't believe in that. We used to have National Economic Council meetings at least twice a month. Sometimes once a month, but at least. He believed in trying to speed up that process. But again, I'm saying we could have done it even quicker. So it isn't the threshold of the amount that these people have to invest that's the challenge. It's our process. It's the laissez-faire approach we take to processing these things. And I just can't. Why we do it outside of a culture of this kind of lethargy is somewhat beyond me. But we have real opportunity here. In the midst of COVID, the Bahamas has gotten, in terms of look, a new look. There are people literally now recalibrated what the Bahamas looks like. Listen to me, folks. Every morning, or most mornings, many mornings, I take a tour around the world. How do I do that? I sit down to my computer, on my TV, sorry, and I go on YouTube and I go news from Africa and I go and listen to what's happening in Kenya, what's happening in Nigeria, what's happening in Botswana and so forth. I get news from Africa. Then I go news from South America and I go find out what's happening in Brazil, what's happening in Chile, what's happening in Argentina and so forth and so forth. I then go to Europe, what's happening in Great Britain, what's happening in Germany, what's happening in Italy, and so forth. Eastern Europe, what's happening in Russia, what's happening. I go in Asia, Central America, North America. I do this because I'm trying to get a sense of what's happening in the world. And what I discovered in doing that is easiness and unsettledness around the world. And I'm not talking about the economic uneasiness and unsettledness caused by the pandemic. I'm talking about political challenges, disruptions, and so forth and so forth. And in the wake of that, I said, you know what? The Bahamas is a paradise-looking place. And the world is seeing that too. And so we may have a new opportunity, but we may mishandle that opportunity if we don't get to understand what the deal is. This text says, I think we need to shoot for ultra high net worth investors who don't want to mix with the struggling millionaire who will turn around and rent out their USD $1 million home via Airbnb to recoup their investment payment, and Bermuda set their sights high, and so should we. I think that misses the point. I still think that misses the point, because my point is, what we should want is, because an ultra high net worth ought to leave it vacant for 9, 12, 11 months of the year and just come and spend a month, right? What I'm saying is, where you get the most economic gain is by the presence of people spending their money. That's the key. That's why we benefit from stopover tourists as opposed to cruise tourists. Because we understand that those days spent here translate into money. So who is likely to spend more money with you in the country over time? A person who is retired and living in the Bahamas for 6 months, or an ultra-high net worth individual who gives you a construction hit, but spends a couple of months here, bring in all their stuff on their yacht? So I don't even know that we have to fight through it. Why we have to fight? Ultra high. Hey, bring them on. What's the fight? You want those bodies to be able to. So if you get the ultra high net worth individual, they spend some time. If you get the, you call it struggling millionaire. Lord, make me a struggling millionaire, please. Who rents their stuff out by Airbnb? Well, let me ask you a question. If they rent their stuff out by Airbnb, who stays in the Airbnb and where do they stay and what do they do when they stay there? How is that a problem for you? Other than they might unfairly compete with you in some ways, but that's something the law could fix, as some people have said they are seeking to do. How is that a problem for you? Listen to me, man. I don't get it. Bring the retired professional, bring the high net worth, bring the ultra high net worth. My point is, the challenge to us is we can't even process the ultra high net worth with any degree of efficiency. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're gonna take a break, and when we come back, we'll continue our discussion. Really well.
Today, I'm breaking out of this cage.
You work hard. Shouldn't your money be working hard too? RF Mutual Funds are designed to put your money to work with some of the best performing investment funds and a range of funds to suit your unique needs and risk tolerance. So when you're hard at work, you can be confident your money is too. Put your money to work with RF Mutual Funds. Call us at 603-6000 or visit rfgroup.com to learn more. RF, money at work.
The Water and Sewage Corporation advises residents of Tropical Gardens and Alexandria Boulevard East, Nassau Village, who may be planning new construction or have commenced new construction and have not yet done and are planning to do so, to urgently apply for city supply due to upcoming road paving works, as once the works have been completed, the corporation will not be able to accept any new applications due to the roads having already been paved. For further information, please call 302-5599.
You asked for it, and now it's here. Introducing the all-new plant-based Rebel Whopper, only at Burger King Nassau. The new Rebel Whopper is everything you expect in a Whopper, with a meatless plant-based patty that is flame-grilled to perfection with all the fixings you love on that famous sesame seed bun. Come try out the new Rebel Whopper with fries and a Pepsi and see if you can tell the difference. The Rebel Whopper is 100% Whopper, 0% beef, and only at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
Sheila, you okay? I see smoke coming from your window.
Chad, Johnny Mo's burning down the house frying chicken.
Your kitchen is a mess. You have insurance?
If I have insurance,
I pulled my phone out, pulled up the Royal Star Assurance app, and in no time, I was on live chat with RSA rep. Sent pics of the damage, filed my claim on the spot.
Wow, I don't think my insurance got that kind of...
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Come next day. Stay. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm, let me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you've been down.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. We are speaking about Mr. Johnson's thoughts about minimum $1 million threshold for permanent record residency, economic permanent residency. If you want to call, give us a call at 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. Do we have a call on the line? No? Okay. So let me read this text. Says yes, but we don't want them competing with Airbnb with Bahamians. Really? I mean, seriously? We don't want them competing with Bahamians. Why? Because the Bahamians are not a high net worth individual. You're a millionaire. You build something for yourself that you're going to rent out. Who's going to build something, compete with them? The Bahamian who's a millionaire or high net worth individual can't build the similar something. We can't compete. Bamboo Shack could compete with KFC, but and Popeyes and them, but in this space, other millionaire Bahamian millionaires and ultra high net worth individuals cannot do so. Ah, come on, man, y'all stop. Send the struggling millionaires with crowd. The struggling millionaires will crowd out and turn off the ultra high millionaires billionaire class. Okay, because that's happening in New York. Yeah, okay. So what is our aim, national policy, the PR carrot tool? The aim is simple. The aim is very simple. You need bodies with disposable income present in your country for extended periods of time to increase the economic transaction in your country. That's called growth. That's what leads to growth. That's the what's the economic aim of tourists to your country? The economic aim of tourists to your country is bodies in beds, waking up in the morning for days, spending in the country. That's how you get and earn income. It's the same thing, only in this instance, it's tied to a different kind of metric where you're saying to somebody who's looking in that direction that I'm going to give you this convenience that you desire so that you can participate in the country. I didn't know we had to explain that, quite frankly, today, given our long-term relationship with this. This text says, Mr. Laing, today, is the Oban deal still active? If not, what is political talk all about? I don't know that it's not active. I don't know that it's not active. But I don't know what the deal is with it today. So fling open the doors to all Russian oligarchs and Iranians. Yeah, look away, you gone. No. You have them coming here to the Bahamas now. But what about the Americans? What about the British? What about the French? That's where you went. I mean, come on, man. I don't accept that. That's just wrong on many levels. Who tourists are coming here? Who tourists? How do you know who's coming here? Come on, y'all. Let's wake up, man. Let's don't do that to ourselves. Anyway, I think that we have an opportunity, and I think that we should be more liberal with the opportunity. And I think that the government seems to be looking to be broader. But I don't want the government to miss the point. The real issue is we can't even take advantage of existing permanent residency applications. Because we do not ourselves efficiently and effectively harness the applications we now have. And I think that's the central issue. We may find that we don't have to change anything if we do the process more effectively and efficiently, because what we will find is the word we get, oh boy, the Bahamas is really efficient. You get an answer, yes or no, very quickly. And that's what people are looking for more often than not. Yeah, this text says, I like that initiative for consideration of permanent residency, not citizenship, great, but permanent residency. We need to attract those kind of high net worth individuals to counter the influx of economically deprived and tax draining individuals that sneak into our country yearly. I think it's a great initiative. Countries are melting pots and the income of these persons will trickle down into the economy. We need that injection. It won't even trickle down. It will actually just be injected into the economy in many ways, because if, depending on the nature of the people and their interactions, you know, I hear folks talking about ultra net worth individuals. Let me give you an example of something. I told you all this before. A very connected person indicated to me that they have comes to a very high end of property in the Bahamas. And when discussing with that friend something, the friend said to them that they had been coming to the Bahamas for a long time, but had not been to downtown Bay Street in years. We miss it. We don't understand it. We don't understand how economics work. We like to dump on poor people. We like to dump on average people, but average people spend money throughout the economy. Let me tell you something. You want to catalyze the growth of the economy quickly. You get money in the hands of construction workers. They're not high net worth individuals. They're not ultra high net worth individuals. But their money will stretch far and wide. The girlfriend getting it, for the children to be able to go get fed, the rent person getting it, the liquor store can get some, the food store can get some, the restaurants can get some. Money. They're not high net worth individuals. What does that tell you? High net worth individuals and super ultra high net worth individuals both have a similar reality. They got so much money, they can be very discerning about what they do with it, inclusive of spending in certain places where you will never see it. But a retiree, they got to manage that money because it got to stretch over the life of their retirement. But what you think they can do with it? Being a food store, going out to eat. If you provide outings for them and things like that, they'll do. They'll spend the money where? Right where they live. You got to stop theorizing about life and stuff like this, man. When you live in the real world and you look at what is happening in the real world, you can see how money is spent. You can see how it gets spent. And you try to go for the spending because it's the spending that gets you the economic growth. And it's the spending that you want. Anyways, I think that, like I said, I like the thinking, the direction of the thinking. That means there's a desire to be flexible. There's a desire to be innovative. There's a desire to look at this area. There's a desire to do new and different things. I like that. Just I'm hoping that we can think through it sufficiently and to be able to find a way to make it work sensibly for us, because we need it. Yeah, going to need it for a little while. All right, so that was Mr. Pintard and Mr. Johnson today. This text says, that is rather the point of having a policy, not tourist permanent residence. No, I'm sorry, you're wrong. Tourism is government policy. All right. The fact that we focus on tourism is government policy. A permanent residence is just another policy. There's no sophisticated difference between this. It's all government policy. All right. Whatever the government does as a focused and intentional thing, it's government policy. All right. And the distinction between the government's policy in relation to tourists and the distinction between the government's policy in relation to permanent residents is only a distinction in size, because the aim is the same, to have them inject economic gains in the country, period. You could try to slice that and dice that all you want. The only reason why the government of the Bahamas is interested in a tourist and interested in a permanent resident is because they both can make an economic contribution to the Bahamas. Even y'all don't have no interest in them outside of that. Why is the illegal Haitian immigrant not regarded so highly? Because they make, we believe, an economic extraction from the Bahamas. We don't count their labor contribution in areas where Bahamians don't participate. We don't count that. We just see that they make money here and be regarded highly by us. And nobody's going to have any special programs for them outside of capturing them, breaking down shanty towns and sending them back home. I'm totally understood. Why do we have an interest in them? Tourists who come here, because they're coming with money. What if those tourists were coming here and didn't stay in your hotel, didn't spend any money yet? Just walk around all day. Just imagine that. They walk straight past the straw market, straight past the lunch vendor, straight past the restaurant, straight past everybody, took every nickel or dime they came off the ship on, right back on the ship, every nickel and dime they came off the plane on, right back. We would have no interest in them. The aim is, the objective is economic injection. All right, this isn't rocket science. This isn't something Zhivargo knows because he's been a minister responsible for finance in the Bahamas. That has nothing to do with it. This is just common sense. Share common sense. Why are we interested in the tourist? Why are we interested in the permanent resident? Economic injection. So the question for the Bahamas in respect of its policy is, which the Ministry of Tourism has always been focused on, how do you get that person to stay longer and spend more. That's always been tourism's aim and objective, because they know that's how you get the value. Well, if the Ministry of Tourism is focused on that, why should not the Bahamas similarly be focused on that with respect to permanent residency? And as a matter of fact, let me tell you something what is probably true. The government of the Bahamas should probably take the permanent residency issue out of the Ministry of Immigration and put it in the Ministry of Tourism. Right? Maybe that's where you can get more consideration about how people behave. Because here's what the Ministry of Tourism is very good at. They are very good at analyzing people's motivations and behavior. What is it that they spend? Why do they spend this way? Where do they spend mostly? Imagine the Ministry of Tourism responsible for permanent residents, and therefore applying their analytical tools to the area of permanent residence. Imagine how much more effective promotionally and otherwise that might be. Maybe that's why we don't do it as well as we do it, because we're not treating it like another part of our travel industry, like another part of our tourist industry. Yeah, they might defy the definition of tourism because of the long-termism of their thing, but that's all right. You want effectively to attract the people, then effectively to process the people, and then effectively to extract from these folk by virtue of the many offerings you have in the country, whether housing or accommodation or transportation or entertainment and the like. You want to be able to give them that value so that they would be free to spend that money in your country. And maybe tourism can help us better. Boy, that idea hit me just now. I think I'm gonna discuss that with some people who might know better than me what the deal is. It's Texas. Good show, buddy. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. I mean, let me tell you something, right? I offer these thoughts not because they are perfect, not because they might be the best ones, etc. But sometimes, you know, they might stimulate us to have other thoughts. And I can tell you one thing. The Commonwealth of the Bahamas' trajectory going forward is going to be a function of our thoughtfulness. You want me to say it again? The economic trajectory, the social trajectory of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas is going to be a function of our thoughtfulness, our ability to think through our issues. Yes, we can disagree with each other. Yes, we can have competing thoughts. Yes, we may even buck a heart against each other, but that's all right. In the end, if that discussion can lead us to find ways and try ways of doing things better, and then maybe evaluating and finding out we might have to make more adjustments, then bless the Lord, thank you, Jesus. That's the way it should be. Listen, y'all have a great evening. God bless you. You've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. Nahaja Black is up next. We'll talk to you again tomorrow. Take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand.